Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Our meeting will now come to order. At this time, I'm going to ask Commissioner Boswell if he will have an invocation.
Let's bow our heads, please. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for all the blessings you have bestowed on us. And God, be with us tonight as we go about the county's business and help us to make the right decisions that will affect our county. And God, be with our troops as they're overseas and fighting to defend the privileges we have tonight to sit down and discuss the issues of the county. These things we ask in your name. Amen.
Amen.
Okay, at this time, I will... public comments. So Donna and Beverly, y'all don't want to talk here, right? You don't want to talk for public comments? Yeah, okay, that's fine. Ann Vaughn, you are up.
Good evening, Commissioners.
Good evening.
Nice to see you again. Mm-hmm. Before I say anything, I want to say, really, I have a lot of high praise for Jason Martin and the planning board. Let me give you a little bit of history, and this is why I'm here. When I was a young teenager, I was in the area, and that was an earthquake. I never forgot the feeling. If you saw the recent pictures of what happened in Virginia with that earthquake and what the damage it was done to the homes, you can better understand it. I was in several homes within the last couple of years when blasting was occurring. I thought I was another earthquake. It was that bad. Cracks in the walls. Doors no longer closed. China falling out of the China cabinet. Things getting broken. That's visual things I could see. On the outside of the house, what about the wells? What about the septic tanks? This is all stuff out in the county. Damage to these homes. Article 1 of Section 2, in essence, says that you try to balance industry with the general welfare standards of the citizens. If this is true, then it is essential that hard mining, which is defined in the booklet, includes any type of mining activity where the extraction or removal is accomplished through the use of blasting or explosives, be moved from Class 3 to Class 4. Which would be moving it from 1,000 foot buffer to a 2,000 foot buffer. And the second item that I would like to see happen would be the measurement would be from the center, not be from the center of operation, but from the perimeter. I know that you need to balance out industry and what happens with industry and what happens with our people. There was an elderly man out cutting his grass one day. It was in the summertime, blasting started. It did have a terrible effect on this gentleman. Structure of the home, wells, septic tanks, the environment, the air, sediment in streams, and we saw a lot of pictures of what was happening there and what happens in those streams goes into the rivers and into the lakes and so forth and into our water supply. So with some slight adjustments, or tweaking, this ordinance would adequately address the unique nature of Alamance County and will achieve its intended goal of allowing for the placement and growth of industrial land uses with maintaining the health, safety, and general welfare standards of established residential and commercial areas. We just made it.
Right on time.
Thank you. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. Okay, next up is Ben Anfacher.
Good evening. Thank you for the opportunity to address you again, and I appreciate this open comment section that you have every meeting. You've heard me before. Tonight I'm not here to talk about the sheriff. I believe I have a cordial relationship with the sheriff, and I appreciate the nice things he said about me in this room. I'm here to talk about Fairness Alamance. I'm a member. This is a group that formed in 2008 in response to our county's policies toward immigrants and to exercise our democratic rights to work to change them. We collected data in order to make credible arguments for change. We spoke in this and other forums to educate the public on the issue. Some of us helped political candidates we thought would bring change we wanted. When the U.S. Department of Justice asked some of our members about the data we had collected and asked us to publicize the department's desire to talk with residents about their perceived civil rights grievances, our people cooperated. This is how concerned citizens are supposed to act in our democracy. Now, Tom Morawski, who's not here, in a comprehensive Alamance News article, reports that a lawyer hired by this board has argued that, quote, lawyers in the Justice Department Civil Rights Division teamed up with local political activists, I presume they mean Fairness Alamance, to launch an investigation of the Sheriff's Department. Your lawyer is quoted as saying that DOJ's talking with members of Alamance Fairness, at the same time Fairness Alamance was endorsing the sheriff's opponent, is some kind of an offense. This is ridiculous. None of us has any control over the Justice Department, nor should the department concern itself with the political preferences of the people its investigators talk with. I just want to set the record straight and caution you about the strength of your case. Thank you.
Okay. Next is Jeff Slaughter.
Good evening, Commissioners. My name is Jeff Slaughter. I live across from South Atlantic Galvanizing on Highway 54. And I'm here, I would like to include steel galvanizing plants to the list of polluting industries in this ordinance. I do have some pictures I would like to show you if I could, if we have time.
Well, you have 3 minutes.
Okay, can you look, have a look at something? I just wanted to show you what we have to do for this. Those are the emissions from the galvanizing plant. You can see it, taste it, smell.
I have been down there several times at night.
Have you noticed?
And I've never seen
the if the atmosphere is calm, that's the best time to see it.
Yeah.
The wind is blowing, it takes it away.
I've never seen any of this down there. And I've been midnight and then morning and just sit on the side of the road.
I've got plenty of video you could watch too, but we wouldn't have that time come down.
Okay.
Those are taken over a period of a couple of years. I would just like to see it included in the ordinance.
If you want to go ahead and talk to her, is that all you want to do with your pictures?
That's fine. I wanted you to look and
okay.
See what we're living with down there.
We don't have any more public comments. I will close the public comment section. I do have commissioners' responses. Do we have any responses at all?
I would like to get Jason or whenever he talks about this ordinance to talk about the issues that Ann brought up, and wasn't there four?
Yes.
Was there another one?
Just you two.
Yeah, I want some specifics as to what Ann was talking about, too.
Well, Mr. Slaughter, if you would call me, I'll be glad to come down there when that happens.
Okay.
And before you leave, I'll give you my number if you don't have it. All right? Okay. All right, next we are going to open the public hearing for heavy industrial ordinance.
Madam Chair, Commissioners, good evening. You should have in your packets a memorandum from me kind of highlighting the process that was followed with the heavy industrial development ordinance that you have before you, as well as a draft of the ordinance. And then I've also included a few maps with this to kind of add a visual. Some of you have seen a few of these maps, I believe. Under the different classifications, class 1, 2, 3, and 4, the spacing requirements at 2,000 feet, at 1,000 feet, at 500 feet, and at 250 feet. And the maps that you're looking at, those are assuming that an industry owned the entire spacing requirement. And the only way, the best way, and really the only way to calculate that is to take that as the area of a circle. Of course, no lot is a perfect circle. So you calculate that out and determine how many acres it would take for the industry to own that entire radius. And you've also got a table there. This is something that I had given to the planning board upon their request quite a while back, and it gives you the calculations from 500 feet to 2,000 feet. It does not have 250 in there, but I can tell you that 250 translates into approximately 4.5 acres. But that's should provide a good visual there with that. Also, I handed out a supplemental packet of information here with regards to the makeup of the planning board. And the planning board, based on their occupations, this is at the planning board as of January 1st, 2011. It should have a breakdown there. As you see, we have a real person in real estate, a banker, an accountant. One of our members is retired from the medical industry, a retired law enforcement officer, three farmers, an electrical engineer, an electrician, and then another that is self-employed. I would include that in the construction business as well. And then construction general contractor, which would be our commissioner that's on the board as well. So. And then also, based, you should have another pie chart in there of the planning board members, the distribution by township. And you can see that they have one member from Melville Township, two from Boone Station, two from Pleasant Grove, one from Albright, one from Fawcett, one from Patterson, two from Newland, one from Morton, one from Graham, and then one commissioner, which is a non-voting member. And then the next page is a map showing all of those townships, the representation there, as to how many townships in the entire county are represented. And the point on that is just to kind of show the broad array of occupations the folks on the planning board have in their professions, as well as the broad area which they represent in the county. In that additional package, you also have a resolution from the Alamance County Chamber of Commerce in support of the proposed ordinance. A memorandum which some of you probably will remember from Clyde Albright, from the county attorney, to the board regarding legal opinion as to what can be regulated and what we cannot regulate based on land use versus pollution. And then also a quick summary of all of the different ordinances. And these are counties that either have a polluting industries ordinance, a high impact protection ordinance, industrial development ordinance of some sort that matches up with what the planning board has proposed. And you can see the differences in the spacing requirements. Currently, Alamance County's ordinance has a 2,000 foot spacing requirement minimum. Under the proposed ordinance, it would go to a four-tier system of 250, 500, 1,000, and 2,000 feet. Stream setbacks. I'm not going to go through each one of these, but you'll see there's a broad range and then a lot of similarities as well. You'll see some things that are pretty much identical to other places. And then also, at the request of a commissioner, I just kind of gave you, pulled out that section of the ordinance with the classifications based on industries in each classification. As you can see, Class 4, which requires 2,000 feet, that has asphalt plants, fossil fuel generating facilities, landfills, cement manufacturing, and metal recycling. And then at the least restrictive, there are three industries in that: fuel bulk storage, ready-mix concrete suppliers, and inert debris landfills or stump dumps. And then also, I gave you once again a couple of drawings that Todd Lambert on the planning board provided for the planning board to kind of show you what a site plan might look like. So I don't want to really belabor on that, but I do want to also just kind of go over again that the planning board took this issue up at the beginning of 2011, end of 2010, and they did create a subcommittee that held eight public hearings, public meetings. Eight meetings. Those were held on March 24th, March 31st, April 7th, April 14th, May 4th, May 11th, May 18th, and May 25th. And at that time, they determined that they would need to rewrite the ordinance, and as opposed to preparing a rewritten ordinance, they went back to the planning board on April 14th and asked to be given permission to go back and rewrite the ordinance to make sure that this is what the planning board as a whole wanted. And at that point, there were six more meetings scheduled after that, four of which were held. It was then the last meeting was recessed until the June planning board meeting. The planning board has recommended approval of this ordinance. They voted unanimously in July of 2011 to recommend approval. After that, staff identified a few areas that needed to be clarified in the ordinance. We suggested some changes to the ordinance, took it back in August. At that point, it was adopted or recommended unanimously once again. You should also have in the packet the statement of plan consistency, which is a statement that the proposed ordinance is consistent with the land development plan as adopted in 2007. Excuse me. And then also the draft ordinance. To specifically address a few of the questions Mr. Sutton had mentioned, Ms. Vaughn had brought up the notion of setting hard mining to 2,000 feet. Basically, the subcommittee, when they met and proposed the spacing requirements that are in here, they went through each individual industry and talked about what was offensive about them. Was it that it put pollution in the air? Was it that something could spill on the ground? Was it that it was not pretty to look at? That it was just purely aesthetics? And those things. And so this was one area that was delineated out for hard mining versus soft mining. And hard mining meaning the use of explosives for blasting. This was set at 1,000 feet by the subcommittee. And I would defer to the subcommittee as to the exact logic as to how they came about the 1,000 feet. But this was the process that was used. And then also spacing based on the property line, not the center. This was a very lengthy discussion, as I recall, at the subcommittee level, was the discussion of having the spacing requirements start from property line to property line, as opposed to the center of the area of operations to nearest improvement of the protected facility. And the reasoning behind that was they also included a setback requirement for the area of operations, as opposed to the standard building setback, which would say 10 feet off the side property line. They added in requirements for the area of operations, which may go all the way, I think, to 125 feet in the ordinance. And so by having that extra little bit of the extra buffer area there, they felt like this would be sufficient, as opposed to having it from property line to property line. And then Mr. Slaughter spoke about adding steel galvanizing to the ordinance. There was discussion about adding steel galvanizing to the ordinance. And at one point in the process, steel galvanizing was mentioned to add into the ordinance. The planning board, the subcommittee at their next meeting, and then Bill, correct me if I'm wrong, Bill was our chairman of the subcommittee. The subcommittee felt that adding industry and deleting industry was not the purpose of the review of the ordinance. The purpose of the review of the ordinance was not to expand it or contract it, with the exception of swine farming. And the reason why swine farming was taken out is if you look in the existing ordinance, farming is exempt. So it was kind of contradicting itself within the ordinance. Plus, swine farming can't be regulated by the county, even under zoning, unless it's 250 hogs or more. So anything under that, the threshold was 250 or more in the ordinance, which is what we're allowed to do by law. Anything under that, by state law, we can't regulate.
Were they covered by the previous ordinance?
Swine farming?
No. Forgive me. Okay, I jumped to galvanizing and went back to galvanizing.
Okay.
If you finish all the hogs and then go back to
that. Okay. Yeah, I'm done with hogs.
Okay.
The steel galvanizing was not in the original ordinance.
It wasn't covered there.
Yes, sir. And I believe, was that all the questions there?
Jason, Class 4 under the tier approach,
yes, sir,
is no different than what we have today. Is that right?
That is correct. It is 2,000 feet, same as what our ordinance is today.
Can you summarize when we've got variance procedures in the proposed?
Mm-hmm.
That means anything can be appealed, I guess?
Yeah, the variance procedures, anybody can apply for a variance under this ordinance, but a variance cannot be granted for something that would not normally be granted under the ordinance. There has to be something unique to the property that would allow for a variance to be granted. The topography is such that they can't get the spacing requirement, or that they can't plant the screening needed, that sort of thing. So variances can be applied for under the ordinance, but it can't be done to completely circumvent the ordinance. That defeats the purpose of a variance.
And would your planning board review variances?
Variances.
You do it, don't you?
No, it comes to the planning board.
It does.
Us, I think.
So it's done by staff and then to the board here?
Yeah, and I believe the Board of Commissioners would have the final say on that.
Variance.
Let me find that there. Yeah, it's allowed by the Board of Commissioners.
It would come back to us.
But through Planning Board.
Right.
Yeah, the Planning Board can only make a recommendation on it.
The rock quarry that you've got up on past grade level, what's that, on 49?
Yes, sir.
What's the name of that company?
Mark Marietta.
Okay, is that soft or hard or?
They, from my understanding, they do blasting.
Okay, so that would be what?
Hard line.
Okay, and we're saying that would be 1,000.
Yeah, 1,000 feet.
What was your rationalization on that? I am curious about that.
Oh, I was afraid you were going to ask that. I didn't bring my notes, and I'm sitting here listening to Ann and thinking, God, why did we make out 1,000? We went, Ray Cobb, do you recall just offhand? I've got a long list of notes. We spent one entire meeting going down everything on that list, and you know, the truck traffic, the dust it would raise, the noise pollution, any number of things. Chairman Sutton, I am just at a absolute loss. I hate to admit it, but that's the truth as to why we went back to 1,000 instead of 2. We went at this in an approach that said anything that we put down can be amended. This was an attempt to make something more flexible than actually existed. So if you think 2,000 feet would be better, as Ann has suggested, that's not going to bother our committee at all. We were just a group of people with average common sense trying to apply that and make something better than what it was. And I think we frankly did. In our letter to you, let me just read one thing. Ken Walker and I were just sitting there, and we thought it summed it up. What resulted from the planning board and subcommittee meetings is the board's best effort to conduct a balancing act between property rights, environmental concerns, and business concerns. So feel free to change or suggest any changes.
Any more questions?
All the quarries, I am curious about that, because over in Greensboro, they've got a tremendous rock quarry over there, Southeast Guilford High School area, and of course, Martin Marietta and up here. What kind of zones, buffer zones are there in Guilford for that one?
I feel it's pretty safe to say that in Guilford, it would fall under heavy industrial. That would be a heavy industrial use. And a lot of times, I'm glad you brought up that point. A lot of times, industrial zoning under county zoning, they may put in a special use permit or a conditional use permit under that rezoning. And so they may put a requirement there that so much buffer be extended out, additional above and beyond, if they wanted to say 500 feet or 1,000 feet. They could do that, the board, at the time of the rezoning. It really is going to vary from place to place, based on what their individual ordinance says. But in general terms, and I feel safe to say that would fall under a heavy industrial zoning, or the most restrictive industrial zoning.
1,000 feet is not even a quarter of a mile. I mean, it's...
No, a quarter is 1,320.
Yeah, I just divided it out. I mean, it's not even close, really. So.
Jason, you probably weren't involved when Highland was built, but I know there was an issue, a question about that buffer between the school and, I think that's also Martin Marietta, isn't it?
I believe
so. Also Huffman Mills. Do you happen to know the distance? I know it's not within the county's jurisdiction. It was city.
Right offhand, I do not. Unfortunately, I don't know that.
Right. But I know that was a question, and mm-hmm. it was addressed. There have not been any issues with that location there. Of course, the quarry was there first.
Yeah, I was going to say, my understanding was the quarry was there before the school.
So. Well, if we don't want to change that, all we have to do is change
it. Yeah, and we can. So. That's the part about bringing this out.
That's right.
Can I make just a point to something, Jason? He kind of alluded to. They did put setbacks in from the actual operation to the property line, which before really wasn't in that ordinance. You had a center operation setback. And also, they took and added in screening guidelines. If you look on behind one of the last pages there towards the end, 918, I believe, they have actual screening, which is something that was not in the other ordinance. It's Appendix A. That's where you'll find it, right behind 18. But they've actually laid out what are the screening guidelines, what are acceptable type things for these businesses to do to make them more presentable to the public.
Madam Chair, if I may just elaborate on what Mr. Boswell was saying. The original ordinance did require landscaping and screening in the original ordinance, but there was no guidelines in place. Mm-hmm. And that was something I actually met with Rhett Davis. God bless Rhett for, even though he's retired, taking time to come in and sit down and give me some ideas. And what I threw to him was, if we're going to have some guidelines here for screening, what are trees that grow well in the county? So that if the industry plants it, that they grow at a rapid rate, they grow large, they grow into a hedge, and that they're not having to plant it 3 and 4 times. And so that's what the guidelines kind of came from, was from that. And that was information I presented to the subcommittee after having met with them. And has also talked with Mark Daniele as well, the current horticulturist for the county.
Right.
Can you go over the amendment process? If we approve this tonight, or even amend it tonight,
mm-hmm.
what about amendments a month from now? What would that process be?
Any ordinance can be amended. We would have to hold another public hearing to amend the ordinance. We would take those amendments through the planning board and get a recommendation and bring back to the Board of Commissioners at that point. And then again, hold a public hearing to do that. So it's I would say probably about a 60-day process safely for an amendment procedure.
But to clarify, this is a new ordinance. This is not an amendment.
That is correct. This ordinance, if approved, will rescind and replace the current high-impact land use polluting industries ordinance and the automobile graveyard ordinance, which, interestingly, was never repealed when the next ordinance was passed. So, of course, the existing ordinance supersedes it, but that's more of a housekeeping matter from a staff standpoint.
Okay. And I'm ready for the public.
Yes, ma'am.
And now we will ask anybody in the public to please state your name.
Good evening. I'm Donna Bonds. I live at 3452 Harris Road in Burlington. Madam Chairperson and Commissioners, thank you for the time to discuss proposed changes of the August 2011 Polluting Industries Ordinance at this public hearing. It is admirable to consider regulations that promote health, safety, and the general welfare of the citizens of Alamance County. We know that each pollutant has its own health risk profile, and that each citizen responds to the risk inherent in pollutants differently. Thus, we rely upon decision makers' knowledge of the potential risks caused by air, water, and land pollution. An earlier study by the World Health Organization indicated that diseases associated with environmental pollution hazards range from 23% to 30%. Thus, the burden of disease is substantial and requires an investment in behaviors that reduce the risk to global communities. Your decisions impact local communities. However, they also impact others around the world. I'm sure that each of us has contemplated the impact of the volcanic ash that halted air transportation to and from Europe, and the impact of the BP Gulf oil spill. Thomas Sowell also noted in a recent editorial that the fallout from decisions is beyond the scope of politicians' tenures in office. Folks understand this, as the scope of air pollution has required regional and state improvement plans due to noncompliance with former EPA standards since the 1990s. Thus, I'm wondering why, when the Blue Ridge Environmental Defense League recommends 2,000 feet setback for polluting industries, according to the Wilkes County Polluting Industry Ordinance, and has also suggested a good case can be made for 3,000 feet setback, that you choose a tiered model with a setback variances between 250 and 2,000 feet. What health profile risk information can you share with us with regard to the impact of tier setbacks on citizen health? In other words, what epidemiological, clinical, or blind health research studies have convinced you that tiered setbacks will not add to the current level of pollution in Alamance County and thereby not affect the health, safety, and well-being of residents now or in the future? Mr. Boswell, can you cite studies that...
Well, we're not doing an air quality nor water quality nor soil pollution ordinance.
But you are...
We're doing land use.
You are saying that...
State has that opportunity to do that.
That's not within our jurisdiction.
Right.
We can't control that. It's been done, it's being controlled by
state
and the
imposes
federal government.
Those.
Counties do not have the authority to control that.
But so you're saying you have no control?
That's
in,
exactly what I'm
in
saying.
In what?
No control
and
whatsoever.
What business you bring into the area and the setbacks and...
We don't
and
have
the
authority. We can't assume authority.
Well, you're
we
taking
not based
authority
on air.
To set the setbacks and you're not saying what impact these setbacks are going to have on the health.
County
and
government is a byproduct, if you will, of the state government. They control what we can do and what we can't do. We don't have that authority.
But you control what industries come into the county. Would that be correct? And you control,
no, we don't.
You're now controlling the setbacks. Are you not controlling the setbacks?
That's the only authority we have.
That's it,
okay.
Just for the land.
So tell me what impact your control of the setbacks will have on the health, the safety, and the well-being of your citizens. Can you tell me that? You don't have that information.
And you can't tell us what it does do on the other side either, can you?
No, but I'm asking you. You're the decision makers, and you're accountable for the setbacks.
We are accountable. Okay. I can't see how fuel bulk storage would impose any air quality pollutants.
How about incineration? Medical incineration. Does that have no impact?
We don't even have that on here, I don't think.
Well, you have waste disposal. Medical waste is incinerated in this county.
But theirs is a 1,000-foot buffer.
I know. Why are you changing it from 2,000 to 1,000?
Well, I think that probably when this committee, what Jason has told me, and Ken, you may want to correct me on this, or that what they did was they went through all of the ordinances, and they decided which ones they thought should not be 2,000. And is that not correct?
That's correct.
And is that an arbitrary decision?
It's a committee decision from the planning board.
It's a committee's decision, but
that's right. And that's what we rely on for them to tell us. I don't know about no health basis. I don't know.
So perhaps they should have a health basis. I noticed that there was no health. There was not a health person or an epidemiologist.
Well, we had a medical person.
A medical
but not
person?
On the committee. I don't think.
But not on
I don't
the
know.
Committee.
Was a medical person?
I didn't hear a medical person mentioned. Was a medical person on the committee?
No.
There is one member of the planning board that's retired from the medical industry.
As okay.
What her role was in the medical industry, I just don't okay. know exactly.
But I'm concerned for the health and the safety and the well-being.
Well, we understand that.
Okay. Okay, what studies have convinced you that the waste facilities, and maybe I should ask you, that the waste facilities, like the medical waste incineration facility, merits a Tier 3 instead of a Tier 4?
Madam Chair, if I may, just to reiterate that this is a land use ordinance. This is not a pollution ordinance. We do not have legal authority to regulate pollution. That's regulated by DENER through the Division of Water Quality, the Division of Air Quality, and the Environmental Protection Agency at the federal level. We do not have authorization to do that. We can regulate land use and the conflicting of land use. And right now, if nothing were to be adopted, then there we do not have zoning. There is no land use protection in this county, unlike Orange County, Guilford County, and other places where they have land use zoning, countywide zoning. There is no other protection. The only thing that we can, and I will just reiterate to the board, that we can regulate is the use of the land. That's all. We can't control how much pollution is put in the air, how much is put on the ground, how much is put in the water. That is an issue for the state and for the federal government. And I have spoken with both the Division of Water Quality and Air Quality and the EPA Region 4 in Atlanta and asked them both, do you have any guidelines for how close one of these industries can be to a house, to a daycare center, to a rural medical center, anything of the sort? And the answer I got from both of them were, that is a local issue. That is a land use issue. That is typically controlled under your zoning ordinances. And we do not have that. So they have reiterated that to us. That was one of the first things that was asked of me by both the planning board and the subcommittee. And I would ask Ken and Bill, am I stating anything but fact?
No, that's actually how we did that. And if you go back, we had the fire marshal in. Somebody else, you went through umpteen different people asking about this because we were looking for something to hang our hat on as far as this very issue went.
I understand.
And as far as the medical issue itself goes, correct me if I'm wrong, Jason, didn't we determine that the smoke and so forth coming out of that place, EPA deemed it safe anyway?
Right. We presume that they're going to do their job.
Right. We had to.
You've got all these permits these people have to go through, but ours, we could only look at the land use, the distances.
I understand it's the land use, but when there's 250 feet, that's not much space between a polluting industry and whatever's adjacent to it.
Well, and Madam Chair, I will also just reiterate as well that under, again, and I hate to labor on the issue of land use zoning and land use law, but in under zoning, if you look at the city of Burlington, I contacted the cities here in Alamance County and asked, is there a spacing requirement saying that industrial zoning can't be located next to residential zoning? And they said no. I can't find a single example of that. So even under municipal zoning jurisdictions, residential can locate right next to industrial. So,
but is that in the best interest of the health, the safety, and the well-being of citizens?
Madam Chair, let me say one thing. One of the things in land use that we wrestle with is this: it's a juggling act. We're not just having to deal with environmental concerns. We're having to deal with commercial concerns, and we're having to deal with property rights when we're talking about land use. All three of those things have to come into play when we're dealing with this issue. It can't just be environment, it can't just be commercial, and it can't just be property rights. It has to be all three blended, and that's what this attempt was, is to make those three things work together.
And I understand that's what your effort is, and I understand that, and I'm not against business and balancing those things, but I'm concerned when the air quality is so out of compliance that I can't be out on days when we have code orange and code red.
Well, I'm sorry. I don't mean to be ugly, but we're here for the land use only. We don't control any of what you're asking us to do here.
Because we can't stop that.
So that's, we need to get back to the basics of what we are here for.
But when you set a limit on the variance, it's going to affect the health of the people.
Well, but we're here tonight just for the land use, okay? So we need to get back to what we are here about tonight. And I appreciate everything that you're saying, and I understand.
Well, I would appreciate it if there would be some due diligence either on your part or on the planning board's part to find justification for the citizens who have concern for the environment, like I do, to find information that supports what you're doing.
Yeah.
Is that an unreasonable request?
I can compare land uses as to how it's done in other jurisdictions, how things are handled under zoning, how they're handled when they're not under zoning.
But
and what I was going at with this as well is that when you have in areas that have zoning that will allow industrial to be right next to residential, now you can't do spot zoning. That's illegal. You can't come into the middle of a subdivision and say, we're going to drop an asphalt plant right there. Can't do that. But at the same time, you can't come in and say, I'm going to build a house right in the middle of an industrial development. So there's in reality, this ordinance actually provides more protection than that. And that's what the point I'm trying to make is there's other jurisdictions in the county that actually provide less protection than this.
Well, I guess my suggestion would be to maintain the 2,000 feet, because I would ask you to consider maintaining the 2,000 feet that is required by the president. Thank you.
Okay. State your name, please.
My name is Beverly Kerr, and tonight I brought my granddaughter with me, Aubrey, and she's going to hold up some photos and maps for me. And this is the first time she's done this, so she's a little nervous. Aubrey, if you'll stand there and hold it so that the commissioners and the audience can see it too.
We have those maps. Okay.
Yeah, that was pretty much what, yeah.
Yeah. Okay, I'll tell you when to hold them up, okay? So I'm a longtime resident and a business owner in Alamance County, and I'm representing several groups, including Blue Ridge Environmental Defense League, and I have just recently joined forces with North Carolina Interfaith Power and Light. We're calling the churches in to help us out, and it's always good to have a little power from above. So together we are asking you to care for creation. Create sustainable projects and community-based partnerships that will improve the local environment. encourage a sustainable society with a precautionary approach for safe policies at all levels. We are asking you to shift the terms of the debate from acceptance of risk to the prevention of harm. Tonight, I have no 3-minute limit, so I have time to say something that I don't usually get a chance to say. Thank you. I want to let you know that I appreciate your friendship, your patience, and your interest in the opinions of Alamance County citizens. I owe you a lot from way back in 2006 when you agreed with our chapter, Be Safe, Not Sorry, and stopped an asphalt plant from opening right in the middle of our neighborhood of residences, farmers raising horses and cattle, churches, daycare centers, campgrounds, greenhouses, and grocery stores. The commissioners passed the polluting industries ordinance that has protected us ever since then. I still remember the meeting room, jammed full of citizens standing on their feet and cheering and applauding our commissioners. The sign still stands on Highway 54 that proclaims, we support the polluting industries ordinance and our county commissioners. I am still grateful to our commissioners and to all the people who speak up for good jobs and clean communities. I'm trying to understand what has changed. Who is it that suddenly wants dirty industry in Alamance County? Why has our planning board suggested such radical changes? And why are our county commissioners even considering actually recruiting polluters instead of regulating them reasonably? All of our group members oppose dangerous facilities, and we call on local officials to continue to take protective action. The ongoing failure of state environmental agencies to require permitting combined with the current budget-cutting fever in Raleigh spells trouble for Alamance County if it weakens existing protections. The setbacks of the current polluting industries ordinance are conservative, effective, and enforceable means of protecting public health and safety. We recommend they remain in place. And Aubrey, if you'll hold up the two big maps. And Aubrey's holding up maps, one that shows you the 2,000 foot distance versus the 250 foot distance. And that's Aubrey on the left and her mother, Elizabeth, on the right. Bill, you remember Lisa and Teresa?
I do, yeah.
So the 2,000 foot land use on the right, the bright blue areas show what's available for polluting industries. These maps came from the planning department. On the left is your 250 foot area, and the yellow is what will become available for some polluting industries based on the tiered effect. So my question is, do we really need that much area open for polluting industry? And will you pick out where your home and business is on this map and think about how you're going to be affected if polluting industry opens next door to you? Those maps are available online if you'd like to look at them. And we have copies of them too at Brettel.org. Okay, you can put the maps down. Thank you. North Carolina counties, towns, and cities are being targeted by dirty industries. Junkyards, waste dumps, incinerators, asphalt plants, galvanizing plants, and other polluting facilities. With little political muscle, meager funds, and less personnel, state and federal watchdog agencies aren't able to protect public health and the environment. This leaves any community targeted by or living with a polluting industry at risk for negative impacts on health, environment, and quality of life. And Aubrey's holding a picture of an asphalt plant. That would be, some people might have the problem of having that as a neighbor and breathing in that type of air. And then this is a Stericycle that Lisa's holding up, our medical waste incinerator during the day and the night. Stericycle medical waste incineration is one of our biggest problems in Alamance County and needs to be addressed. Thank you. Put those down. By working directly with county and municipal governments, health departments, and other local government associations, we want to help make environmental protection a local issue.
We aim to stop or reduce the sources of pollution from polluters who locate in out-of-the-way places in Alamance County and other communities across Tar Heel State. We like to employ the precautionary principle and the golden rule in our work to prevent harm and correct wrongs, and we ask you to do the same. We call on you to be responsive with transparent economic development policies and better environmental protection. We expose and challenge all pollution assaults on communities and people, and we identify more clearly the various sources of pollution. We determine the levels of pollution. We promote safe alternative jobs, products, and technologies. Good jobs and clean communities can be the same project. We have a right to live risk-free in the neighborhood of our choice, where our next-door neighbor is not a trash dump, a junkyard, or some other polluting industries. Our environmental rights must be respected, and we have the right to participate in making the decisions that affect our life and our community. Do you wonder how people became powerless as the corporations became powerful? Why does our government protect the right to pollute more than it protects our health? In Graham, our local league chapter, Neighborhood Environment Watch, NEW, is dedicated to ending the galvanizing plant pollution which has plagued this rural community for nearly a decade. And these pictures are pictures of South Atlantic galvanizing pollution, and these photos were taken from our backyard. And Linda, you may not have seen it, but anyone that looks at these pictures will see that we definitely have a pollution problem. So it hurts me to hear you say that over and again, that you've come and visited and haven't seen it, but you don't live there.
No,
and
I don't.
Jeff lives there, and I live there, and my family has lived there, and we all know that it's a true situation. So please be careful when, if you lead people to believe there's not a problem.
Well, I'm not trying to do that.
Good.
Okay. But I'm just saying, I've been down there on several occasions because I told you I would come down there, and I have.
So. Okay. All right. So the plant operates without a permit from the Division of Air Quality, but its air emissions have contaminated the community and rendered our private property unusable. Soil samples collected by our local chapter groups indicate that cadmium contamination is 140 times above the expected background level. There are high levels of chromium and zinc, which are also known to be emitted from galvanizing plants. Although laboratory test results are conclusive and the state toxicologist supports our cause, the state has proven resistant. The solutions we recommend include getting the state to permit and regulate all such plants and using countywide land use planning to reduce and eliminate harm to property owners. We're requesting you add galvanizing to the ordinance. And this is where you do have a say-so. You can't get involved, I know, in the pollution, but you do have a say-so about where these properties can locate. My family can personally speak about the burden residential property owners face when dirty industry is allowed to open in a neighborhood. Tax values drop, along with the air and water quality and the peace of the neighborhood. How will families feel when they can't plant a vegetable garden because their soil is contaminated from a junkyard or landfill or a galvanizing plant? When they can't sleep at night because of heavy traffic on their roads? When their trees are dying and streams are polluted? Citizens do not want dirty industry in their neighborhood. Neither do schools, medical facilities, churches, or childcare centers. Another of our chapters, Clean Air Now, CAN, wants everyone to know that Alamance County allows Stericycle to burn medical waste from 22 states. I think there is a picture. Do you have the Stericycle map? If you could bring that up and just hold it up. North Carolina healthcare facilities send millions of pounds of medical waste to Stericycle. 62% of the medical waste burned at Stericycle comes from medical facilities located in North Carolina. Medical waste incinerators release toxic particulate matter, dioxins, mercury, heavy metals, nitrogen oxide, hydrogen chloride, volatile organic compounds, plus acid and greenhouse gases. These pollutants contaminate our land and surface waters. Ash from the process becomes concentrated with dioxins and heavy metals and poses a risk to groundwater from landfill leaching. Water used to cool the ash that results from burning is discharged into our rivers and our streams. Incineration is an antiquated, obsolete technology, and better technologies exist and are approved for the safe disposal of such waste. So why does Alamance County allow medical waste incineration? We ask you to support the movement to build healthier communities and to prevent harm in as many ways and for as many people as possible. We ask you to promote human health and environmental integrity. Join us in providing the tools, the direction, and the encouragement to people and to groups so they can build strong, healthy communities where they live, work, learn, shop, play, and pray. Excuse me. Join our efforts to help people and communities prevent harm. We want to provide everyone with enough information to help stop toxic exposure. The proposed ordinance is not consistent with the adopted Alamance County Land Development Plan. It does not balance economic development with environmental protection. It does not reflect community values or encourage quality development for the county. It is not in the public interest, especially in light of information presented in the public hearings, as proven by the materials presented. In fact, the only people who spoke up who weren't against these changes represented junkyard expansions and defending hot-dip steel galvanizing plants. All other local citizens spoke up for sustainable development and protection of the environment and for attracting clean industry to Alamance County. The intended purpose of the current ordinance is not to recruit polluting industry. It is to protect others from the pollution of dirty industry. If this revision is approved, just like the newly proposed name says, this ordinance will be transformed into a heavy industrial development ordinance. The new purpose will be to develop polluting industry. Alamance County needs a lot of things to be healthy and successful, but more pollution is not among them. Think of our children and grandchildren. Think long-term, not short-term. Think of our responsibility to care for creation. Thank you.
Thank you.
Any questions?
Well, is it true that they don't have a permit at that place?
Which place is that? Stericycle?
Right here is their attorney. I'm sure he can speak to that.
It is true.
You want to speak to that?
If you don't mind.
Yeah.
Don Mills.
Good evening. I can answer that question right away or during the whole...
State your name.
I'm sorry. My name is Don Nielsen. I'm here on behalf of South Atlantic Galvanizing, which owns and operates a galvanizing facility off of Highway 54 in Buckner Industrial Park. Pete Peterson, who's the general manager of the plant, and David Monroe, the operations manager, are here with me tonight. I'll get into that question you asked, but the main reason we are here tonight is that for several years there have been efforts to restrict or close South Atlantic's operations, the most recent of which is to attempt to add galvanizing to the ordinance you're considering tonight. South Atlantic has followed the proposed ordinance through the Planning Board Subcommittee and the full Planning Board, and it submitted comments which are public record. South Atlantic greatly appreciates the Planning Board's hard work and the progress made to make the ordinance more flexible and usable while protecting the public. It's an improvement, although there are still very many concerns for covered industries. Galvanizing is not included in the proposed ordinance, and South Atlantic respectfully requests that it stay that way. To give you some background, South Atlantic started its galvanizing operations in 1997. It understood that, given the nature of its operations, and by virtue of being in an industrial park, no one would be surprised or threatened by it. The facility is not visible from Highway 54. It's not a heavy industry. It has no smokestacks. It recycles its wastes. It does not have a significant environmental impact. Its air emissions are fundamentally steam, and the air emissions are so low that no air permit is required. Now, Ms. Kerr and Bredel have continually harped on the point that no permits required, and therefore somehow South Atlantic can do whatever it wants. That is not the case. No permit is required because the emissions are so low that none is required. You have to meet a certain standard, and the conditions are set to protect the health and safety of North Carolina citizens. That, and no permit is required, does not mean that South Atlantic does not have to follow the North Carolina regulations, which are strict and which follow the EPA regulations. Galvanizing is a process, for your information, if you don't know, if the audience doesn't know, it protects items from rust. Materials are cleaned, and then a zinc coating is applied. South Atlantic galvanizes such things as handrails for schools, support beams for construction, signage support for signs and sound walls, and guardrails for highways. South Atlantic is a member of the American Galvanizers Association, and it employs qualified engineers, chemists, and environmental specialists. And due to the upfront cost of constructing the plant, we believe there is only one other galvanizing plant in North Carolina. South Atlantic has a workforce of 40 to 45 people in Alamance County. It contributes to the local economy. It pays taxes on its property, its building, and its equipment. Mr. Peterson and Mr. Monroe and most of the plant employees reside and spend their wages in Alamance County. Since opening in 1997, South Atlantic has met all regulatory and industry requirements which protect human health and the environment. Before beginning its operations, its engineers analyzed and modeled the entire process, confirmed that it would be safe and compliant with all laws. Since that point, it tested its air emissions, and the DENR, the Department of Environment and Natural Resources, came out, tested its emissions. Everything is safe, it is compliant, it is within the regulations. The plant, interestingly, has operated the same way for 14 years. South Atlantic did not hear complaints until the asphalt plant controversy a few years ago. Since then, Mrs. Kerr, who is now a Bredel employee, and certain Bredel publications have stated that they are trying to close down South Atlantic. Bredel has targeted South Atlantic and sought to include it in this and other ordinances without any legal or scientific basis. The bottom line is that the South Atlantic plant is safe, it is compliant, and it is a benefit to Alamance County. It's been tested and retested, it is environmentally safe, it is economically productive, providing jobs and taxes, tax revenue, in difficult and economic times. The plant is located in a platted industrial park, which is exactly where the county land development plan says it should be. The county land development plan calls for an environment, quote, conducive to industrial development. The proposed ordinance, while an improvement over the existing ordinance, still prohibits or discourages industry in a way that seems inconsistent with the county's land development plan. That plan says, quote, that it is to encourage new industrial development to locate in existing and planned industrial parks. But many covered facilities could not locate now in the Buckner Industrial Park under this ordinance due to the land spacing requirements. And if they could go anywhere in the county, they would be forced out into open areas. A 2,000-foot spacing requirement is huge. It is equivalent to 288 acres surrounding whatever size the facility may be, in which in those 288 acres there could be no home, no school, no church. And if an industry could find that much surrounding open space in Alamance County, it would likely not be near other industry. It would likely not be near good roads. As the land use plan states, industries should be located together where there are locational advantages, not pushed out in some sort of industrial sprawl. If the ordinance is ever considered again, South Atlantic would propose, following the county's land use plan, an exception or adjustment for industrial parks. It should further be noted that under the spacing requirement, it would be easy for an opponent to stop new industry or industrial parks, for example, by simply putting up a mobile home within that land spacing area. That is a lot of uncertainty for any industry trying to come to Alamance County. because the word would get out and it would be trouble. Even if a facility could meet the spacing requirements, it still needs a lot of extra land just to meet the setback requirements. A 100-foot setback on a square 10-acre parcel, which is the minimum size parcel in the ordinance, takes away more than 50% of the usable property. If you're a Tier 4 facility, it would take away more, it would leave you only, actually leave you less than 40% of the property to use for your facility. Then imagine an intermittent stream goes through your property. That adds a 100-foot setback on either side of the intermittent stream. So there probably would be no usable land at all. You add a 30 to 60-foot wide vegetative screen around the entire property, which is a very expensive proposition but required by the ordinances, and the chance of new industrial development anywhere in the county under this would seem very slim. South Atlantic, however, is supportive of the proposed changes. They are a definite improvement over the existing ordinance. But if attracting industry is an issue, there could be additional changes in the future which would be beneficial to the county. South Atlantic very much appreciates, again, the planning board's efforts and this board's attention and its patience. And the company respectfully requests that South Atlantic, a good corporate citizen, not be targeted, and that galvanizing remain excluded from the ordinance.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. Anybody else that wants to talk?
Old Stericycle, was it that a Graham project? I mean, Graham?
Yeah, Hall River.
Hall River. Who granted the permit? Not Cal.
Graham.
But we couldn't intervene there if we wanted to.
No, it's Graham.
That needs to be clear.
That's the city of Graham.
Yeah, Graham, not us.
And I can tell you one thing. The man that put the borders in, I know personally, and he said that it's not anything but steam coming out of those borders. Now, he's the man that put them in there. So I'm just telling you what he told me. So I am just telling you that for your information. Okay. Anybody else? Any other questions? Yes, Jason.
Madam Chair, if I can just summarize a few things real quick.
All right. Yes, sir.
I'm not going to take long. I know we've got other things on the agenda tonight, and I don't want to hold everybody here all night long. Just to go back again, there was, I know Ms. Carr had shown the maps, and those are the maps I was referring to that are actually in your ordinance.
Right.
And there are two other maps for 500 feet and 1,000 feet.
Right.
I did want to point that out. And then I wanted to point out as well that the 250-foot area that was shown, that is three industries under the proposed ordinance. That's ready-mix concrete facilities, inert debris landfills, and fuel bulk storage. Those are the three industries that would fall under the 250 feet.
Right.
The 2,000 feet, you see that that is what is existing, and that also would, just to kind of point to the planning board's concerns, was if you see there, the industries that are the properties that are located, several of those are in active farms, and some of those are actually county properties, including Cedar Rock Park. So there's, I believe, 17 or 18 grand total in the county. And then also, just to point out again, that what you have before you is a land use ordinance. It does not regulate pollution. It is specifically a land use ordinance, and it's governed under the laws that give us the authority to regulate land use. Again, air quality permitting, water quality permitting, that's handled by DENR and by the EPA. Those are not issues that we can regulate. And of course, I know there's been concerns brought up about the mining, you know, being 1,000 feet versus 2,000 feet. Of course, I'm a public servant. I serve, and the board is an appointed board. They serve at your will as a planning board, and as a public servant, I serve at the will of the board as well as the county manager and ultimately the citizens of the county. So if there is will to do something different, I will enforce whatever is asked of me to enforce.
Okay.
I just wanted to say,
Jason,
that.
I'm going to ask you a question before you
yes,
leave
sir.
There. The galvanizing plant, were it to be put on this ordinance, they would be grandfathered anyhow.
That's correct.
So, you know, there would be no dissolving of the galvanizing plant were it put in this ordinance. I mean, so it's kind of a moot point to even bother putting it in there. It's there. We've already got, you know, other things here. I just I don't quite understand, and I'm really concerned that Ms. Kerr running daycare, if their land is so polluted, I would be afraid of putting kids out in my yard if I were running a daycare. You may want to take note of that.
Okay.
That's all I got.
At this time, I will close the public hearing since nobody. Is this about the land use ordinance?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. State your name.
My name is Larry Shambly. I live at 3052 Mine Creek Road, and I want the ordinance to stay as it is because I have a neighbor that wants to put in the junkyard, and I fought in the past where he already had one and had to remove it. And I'm looking over this ordinance, I don't understand how you come up with these the setbacks, the 250, the 500, whatever. Like for instance, the junkyard, the class two, is called an automobile salvage storage facility, and it's 500 feet. And then there's in class four, a metal recycling salvage facility, which is 2,000 feet. To me, those are the same, sound like the same thing. So that's one thing I don't understand how, and I don't know how you came up with them anyway. Mr. Sutton just asked the question earlier in the meeting. I don't remember what he was talking about, if it was a class four or five. He asked, how did you come up with 1,000 feet? And then this gentleman said, well, I'll change it to 2,000. Well, let's change them all to 2,000 if it's that simple. I mean, you said that.
Wait.
I mean, if we can change it from 1,000 to 2 just because you don't know why you come up with 1,000, why can't they all be at 2,000?
Well, but they do know why, because I tried to explain that too. They
well,
do
he
know
just
why.
Said he didn't know why.
Well, that one, he didn't know why.
That was
okay.
Specific.
Okay.
Right, but they do know why they changed them all, okay? And I tried to explain that a while ago.
Right. So. Well, and my question to all five of you, would you want to live next to a junkyard or any of these other type facilities?
I do live next to one.
Okay, but did you move there? Was it there when you moved there?
I don't know.
I don't have one there now.
Because I was born in the house I live in, okay?
Okay. I don't have one there now.
Sure.
And I bought the property from the gentleman that wants to do the junkyard. And he pretty much knew what he was doing in the get-go when I asked, so. I mean, I'm a general contractor, and you know where the market is, Eddie. Houses, you know, and they're not selling. And you think if I actually been trying to sell my house, and because of the market I'm in, I mean, times are hard. And putting a junkyard next door to me is not going to help me sell my house. I don't want to sell my house. I love it. I didn't buy that land because I didn't love it. But.
Okay.
That's all I have.
All right, thank you.
Thank you.
Do you want to reiterate anything?
Yes, let me just add one thing. In terms of his specific issues he's bringing up, the difference was a crusher. The one with the 2,000 feet, there's a permanent crusher on site. Jason, right? Am I not right?
That's right.
We had a long discussion, and a crusher is going to create a lot of dust, a lot of noise, but the other one would not have that. It would be very quiet other than just bringing cars in and out.
Okay, thank you. Okay, at this time I'm going to close the public hearing.
Jessica.
Oh, I'm sorry. Are you going to talk about the public hearing?
Yes, ma'am.
Are you
going to
talk?
Rebuttal. I'd like to rebuttal what was just
well,
said.
Well, we're not here to.
Ma'am, I'm.
Okay, well,
lies.
Come on. If you're talking about. If you're going to talk about the public hearing.
It's public hearing.
Yeah, that's fine.
Madam Chair, I don't own any land on Mine Creek Road whatsoever. I have never sold this land nothing. Me.
Okay. Well, I'm not sure he's talking about you.
Well,
I'm his neighbor.
Okay.
I don't have any intent to put a junkyard on Mine Creek Road.
Okay.
The dream for me was Hall River King Auto South.
Okay.
Period. That was my dream.
Okay.
I've not been charged with a crime. I have not been charged for violating any ordinance.
Okay.
I've been brought down here. I've been publicly humiliated and not charged with anything.
Thank you. Have you got something?
This is ridiculous.
I actually pulled Larry's property up, and Tony does not own the property next to him.
That's no legal authority on me.
I was just curious because I did talk to Larry today. And I don't, you know.
Okay. At this time, I'm going
to. Yeah, I want to ask a question. Oh, you want to close that, or let me ask?
No, you go ahead.
All right. The galvanizing, with what they've got now, hypothetically, what tier would they be in if they were in a tier of the new orders? Just curious.
I believe when the short period that it was put in the ordinance, it fell under tier 3, I believe, and then it was taken out, but...
I mean, in the, what we're proposing...
Yeah, because there was a time when the subcommittee had originally put it in, and then they pulled it out. They didn't want to do any adding or deleting of industry. They did some delineation of industry, but no adding or deleting. I believe it was tier 3. I could go back and check the record.
I was curious.
Okay. Well, that's 1,000 foot.
1,000, yeah.
All reservation I have, well, if you want.
Yeah, can I close?
Yeah, I didn't know what.
Okay, this time I'm going to close that public hearing.
You want a motion to close that?
I don't think we need a motion to decree.
We do, motion.
Okay.
I'll make a motion to close it.
Second.
Okay, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Okay.
Yeah, the only reservation I have is the hard mining, at least on the top of the surface.
Yeah.
There might be other things in the future, but the hard mining situation, to have blasting going on less than a quarter of a mile away, to me seems too small. That's just my personal opinion.
Well, do you want to make a motion to move that to class 4?
I would support that, yes.
Okay. Then I'll entertain that motion to move that to class 4.
Aye.
I need a second.
Second that.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed?
So there we
okay,
go.
We can do that, and we can go ahead and vote on this at that point. Is that the only thing we're going to change? Is that correct?
Yep. Madam Chair, can I just
say
one thing? I talked to a couple of municipal officials since this hearing was planned, and one specifically kind of struck me. The municipal official relayed the story that a business, an existing business in one of our towns, was moving and looked in the county and was not able to find suitable property because of the existing land use plan, and in fact ended up moving within the city limits of the town he was in. And it was very concerning to the business owner because he felt like the options really weren't available.
And that was when it was 2,000 feet on everything, right?
Yeah, yes. When it was under 2,000 foot on everything.
So I think, and as the Chamber's proclamation said, you know, we do want to provide flexibility. Beverly, I'm very concerned about air pollution. I grew up in a town that was heavily polluted, and it's not the right thing. I do think there's a balance, though, and I think by creating opportunity for businesses to come in, that's my personal belief is I don't think we're going to sacrifice the air and water quality that you speak of. I'm very concerned about it as well. I think that we do need, and I think the Planning Board discussed in their deliberations, ways to attract business into Alamance County. We've said all along, I think we have to create the environment that will make business want to come to Alamance County, and good business come to Alamance County. And for that flexibility and for the opportunity to do that without sacrificing what I consider to be the pollution that you make reference, I certainly intend to support what's being presented.
Okay.
Well, and I want to make a little bit of a comment back to Beverly saying that nobody was over there talking for this ordinance as it was being heard out in public hearings, but at 10 point something unemployment in this county, they were probably out looking for a job, which if this does create a job, I'm sure they would have been there talking for it had they recognized the fact that this may bring that industry here that they can do. I ride by an asphalt plant every time I go home. They're paving a lot of roads around this county. I don't know how many of you rode a horse and buggy up a dirt road getting here tonight, but I like riding on asphalt. I do, and you know, I understand there needs to be a balance. I definitely agree with you. We don't do the air quality. We don't do the water quality. That's not in our jurisdiction. The state, Deaner, as Jason said, is responsible. Breedle got the Jordan Lake rules in place. They went to the state, though. They didn't do it on a local level. If you're concerned about the air quality, spend more time in Raleigh, I guess. I hate to say that, but that's where the problem is.
Okay. So are we ready for a motion to accept this with the changes that will be made? Okay.
I'll make that motion.
I have a motion.
I'm second.
Second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
No opposed? Aye. Okay, next we have I want to open another public hearing, please, for Housing Development CDBG Grant Closeout.
Good seeing you.
Yes, she said I know I was late.
You
mean it was
unanimous?
Yeah, it was unanimous.
Yeah, I heard the same thing.
No, it was unanimous.
You want to make that clear?
It was unanimous. It was unanimous.
5-0.
You got that, Tori.
She just said sure about
Mr. Lavender asked.
Yeah, I did not bet against her. No, I didn't. No, I just meant I didn't say I when y'all did, and I'm like, oh, I. Okay.
5-4-0
Okay. Madam Chair, now for the main event, we'll go on to this part. You should have in your packet tonight a memorandum from me regarding the Housing Development CDBG project. This is to, public hearing is to close out the project. Staff is preparing to submit the closeout documentation to the state. Just a quick reminder, this was for $250,000 for the Bend Court subdivision. It was a partnership between the county and Habitat for Humanity. Robin Winteringham has sat here this evening, is here to answer questions from you guys as well. I will just say that it's been a real joy to work with Robin on this project. And as I said at the last meeting, being that this was a project that the county employees also helped to construct some of the houses there as part of the United Way fundraiser, on a personal level was very a very interesting project and gratifying to be able to work from the grant application through actually driving nails at the property. So, but there is no action required of the board tonight. Only thing we need to do is to take comments from the public. And I'll be glad to take any questions if you have any.
Public hearing is open on this. Does anybody have any comments? You may.
Robin.
Please state your name.
My name is Robin Winteringham. I'm the Executive Director of Habitat for Humanity of Alamance County. I just want to thank you all for your support in this project. It's been very exciting for us. It's been very rewarding for the 14 families who now call Bend Court home. We have three more houses to build there, and then we're putting in a public playground. So it has been a wonderful opportunity for us to be here in Graham. And again, we just thank you for your support.
You're so welcome. All right. Anybody else? If not, I'd entertain a motion.
Make a motion.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
No opposed. Very good. Okay, next we have a presentation and proclamation. Adult Home Care, CAC, and Nursing Home CAC.
Madam Chair, Commissioners, my name is Don Hermans. I'm the Regional Long-Term Care Ombudsman for Alamance County. I work with the Piedmont Triad Regional Council Area Agency and Aging. And I also have the honor of working with the members of the Adult Care Home and Nursing Home Community Advisory Committees. These people that you appoint are a very dedicated bunch, and I'd like them to stand up. We have several members here. And if you'll just introduce yourselves and
Diane Robinson, and I'm with the Community Advisory Committee. I'm chair.
Right.
I do assisted living and family care.
Right. Okay.
Mary Bozeman, Nursing Home Committee.
David Spruill. Okay.
Grace Baldwin, I'm chair of the Nursing Home Committee.
Right.
Juanita Davis, I work with Diane on the advisory committee.
I'm Lisa
Max-Martinez
on the adult
care.
Okay, thank you.
I meet with these folks 4 times a year. They go out and visit the 8 nursing homes, the 16 adult care homes, and the 41 family care homes here in Alamance County. And I think they would tell you it's a very rewarding role that they play in visiting these residents. The Ombudsman Program and the Community Advisory Committee were brought about with the introduction of residents' rights for nursing home residents and those in adult care homes and family care homes. And traditionally, the first week of October is recognized as Residents' Rights Week. And this year, we're asking to recognize the whole month of October as Residents' Rights Week. And I have a proclamation I would like to read for your approval.
Okay. That'll be fine.
Okay. Whereas there are more than 1.6 million individuals living in 16,000 nursing homes and 1 million individuals living in 50,000 board and care assisted living facilities in the USA. And whereas the Federal Nursing Home Reform Act of 1987 guarantees residents their individual rights in order to promote and maintain their dignity and autonomy. And whereas all residents should be aware of their rights and so they may be empowered to live and with dignity and self-determination. And whereas we wish to honor and celebrate these citizens to recognize their rich individuality and to reaffirm their rights as community members and citizens, including the right to have a say in their care. And whereas individuals and groups across the country will be celebrating Residents' Rights Month with the theme Welcome Home, creating connections between residents and the community to emphasize the importance of affirming these rights through facility practices, public policies, and resident-centered decisions, making that impact, decision-making that impacts quality of care and quality of life. So now, you know, I'd like to ask you to proclaim the Alamance County Board of Commissioners hereby proclaim October 2011 as National Long-Term Care Residents' Rights Month in Alamance County, North Carolina, and encourage citizens to recognize these observations. I'm not familiar with your procedure at this point, but I think the important thing is these people are that connection between the community and these facilities. They are going into these facilities. Some are locally owned, some are owned by big corporations that may be in Chicago or Albuquerque and things like that. So I think it's important to realize that people here in the community are interested in the care of these residents and making sure their rights are being respected. Thank you.
Do I hear a motion to
reconsider?
So moved. Motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Thank you.
I ask a question in a nutshell. Yeah. How are we in our county for bed space availability at the level that you cover?
Well, you know, as I pointed out, there are like 41 family care homes, and a family care home is where someone's licensed to take care of people in a home, anywhere from 2 to 6 residents. I would say that those facilities aren't all at 100% occupancy, you know. Most of the adult care homes, I think, are fairly full. The adult care homes and the family care homes that are monitored by the Alamance County Department of Social Services, and nursing homes are monitored by the Department of Health Services regulation at the state level.
Doesn't the state grant the bed capacity
for nursing homes and adult care homes? They have to have a certificate of need,
right
to open a facility. And so if a facility were to close down, then somebody might purchase that certificate of need, you know, perhaps to build a new, you know, facility somewhere in the county.
Are we okay with our demands versus?
I think yes, I think so. The only thing I would say as far as nursing homes go, we really only have one nursing home that has a dementia care unit, and that's Twin Lakes at this time. And certainly, I think that we could certainly use more of that. But people who may have a parent who has dementia that needs nursing home level of care but needs to be in a secure unit may have to go to Bryan Center in Yanceyville or something like that.
They were talking on TV this weekend. I'm not sure where I was watching it, C-SPAN. Somewhere where they were saying that the dollars that are going to need to be spent on Alzheimer's and dementia is just going to be staggering in the future.
Oh, I'm sure it is. Yeah,
staggering.
You know, you can see I'm getting there myself.
What do you count as services for dementia? The home place, for instance, has a unit.
Well, yeah, they're an adult care home, and certainly people that are, let's say, an adult care home are people who maybe don't have chronic or severe medical needs, and they don't need to be in a facility that, let's say, has 24-hour nursing care. So they would be providing what we might call assistance with activities, the daily living, dressing, and bathing, and things like that. And certainly Home Place and Clare Bridge, you know, are several of the facilities that provide that type of care. But if they needed nursing home care, that's what I'm saying.
So the combination of physical needs plus dementia?
Right, right. They, you know, a lot of times with people with Alzheimer's, when they're first diagnosed, you know, may be relatively healthy physically otherwise.
And I think what you need to hear is skilled.
Yes, skilled care.
That's,
right.
That's the key word. Twin Lakes Memory Care has the
skilled care.
You know, actually, my mother was in both. She started at Home Place. And
I visited, yeah. I remember when I done my
thank you.
Twirling around.
Well, thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Thanks. Thanks for what y'all did.
That was good, too.
And now I will recognize Susan Roberts, so we can set a public hearing for ambulance financing.
Good evening. If you'll remember, during the budget process, it was approved for the county to proceed and purchase and refurbish ambulances for the EMS services. We would request that a public hearing be set for the next commissioners meeting, October 17th, to discuss the bid award for the financing. The RFP has been sent out, and the bid opening will be Wednesday, October 5th at 11 o'clock.
Okay. Do I hear a motion?
Motion.
Second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Thank you.
Yes, ma'am. Okay, county manager report.
Just a quick update. Today was the first session of Superior Court at Historic Courthouse, and Judge Allen did serve, Judge J.B. Allen did serve in that role today and was able to preside. And Kim was there, and he was very complimentary of this board and the work that you've done and the commitment that you had to the Historic Courthouse. And we're going to try to get you a video that Scott took of that first session. So we'll try to email that to you.
Did you say
who was there?
J.B. Allen.
Yeah.
Now, do you have any videos left of the courthouse?
Yes, sir. We
did. I don't have them either.
Yeah, I have a couple of people who have asked for them. And
more than happy to get those for you, too, as well. So. But other than that, I have nothing else to say.
Okay. Well, with that, the consent agenda, does anybody want to remove anything from that?
I make a motion. We go ahead.
Okay. Have a motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
No opposed. At this time, we are going to go into closed session. I move that we now go into closed session pursuant to North Carolina General Statute Section 143-318.11A3 in order to preserve the attorney-client privilege between the county attorney and the Board of Commissioners to consider and give instructions to the county attorney concerning the handling or settlement of the case of RSM versus Alamance County and the handling of claims arising out of the dissolution of the Alamance Castle LME.
So moved.
Second.
I'm going to have my water in there.